Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Let us read the James, the third chapter together. But the wisdom, together. Let's start again. But the wisdom that comes from heaven
is first of all here.
Also, too, in the Amplified Version of the same chapter, it gives a different perspective. Let's read that together. Impartial and unfeigned, free from doubts, wavering, and insincerity. Okay, now let us also look at Matthew's 5th chapter, the 9th verse. Let's read together. Amen. As we are, again, our study has been from the lexicon of the annual scriptures that are preached. Our scripture comes from James, the third chapter. And the selected title of our sermon this morning is Peacemaker or Hellraiser. Amen? Peacemaker or Hellraiser. Amen. Now, again, we're going to examine, we're going to read the scripture, because again, this is not the gospel according to Cheryl Galladay, but this is the gospel according to the scripture. Amen? Now, we have to admit that getting along with people is not the easiest thing to do. Amen? Amen. Are you there with me today? Now, the thing is that it's a fact of life that if you live or you work or you associate with anyone, you will, in some time, experience some form of conflict. Amen. Now, if you hear something of which I've stated that you agree with, it's okay to say amen, because that lets me know you are up there. Amen. Otherwise, I'm going to think I'm up here talking to myself, and I know that's not the case. Amen. Hey, you're all right. Okay, now, let's look at this. The only way, and when we talk about conflict, the only way you can avoid conflict is if you were to live by yourself, or if you were to go on a paradise island, or you were to go on a top mountain, and no one else lived there but you. Then you wouldn't have to worry about conflict. Amen? But the thing is that who wants to live like that? And for, I guess, it may feel good for a little bit, right? Maybe a couple of days, but then after a while it's like, hey, I need somebody to look at and somebody to talk to, right? So the thing is that, again, we are all going to have some form of conflict in all of our lives. But the thing is that when we look at this, let me ask somebody a question here. How many of you are in contact with people from day to day? Let me see. Okay, so I guess this sermon is for you. Together with people, conflict is inevitable, because everybody's not going to agree with you, and everybody's not going to see things the way you see them, and so forth and so on. But even among the best of friends, friction is a sign of life in a relationship. Amen? So here, Proverbs 27:17 tells us what? Iron sharpens iron. So a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. In other words, friction within a relationship isn't necessarily bad, but conflict doesn't have to escalate into World War III. Amen? Now, every time two people disagree, there's a way to resolve the differences peacefully. And one can do so in a way that strengthens relationships rather than destroying them. And today we will look at what the Bible says about the ways in which to handle conflict and the ways in which to handle interpersonal conflict in our lives. Now, why is being a peacemaker so important? Well, the scriptures tell us in 1 Corinthians 6 and 20, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Also, in 1 Corinthians 7, 23, it tells us, ye are bought with a price. Be not servants of men. In other words, we owe it to one another because in the sense that we owe it also to Jesus Christ because Jesus purchased our redemption. And so therefore, although we sometimes have difficulty and we have the nerve to meet with people who tell us, well, I'm just being myself, or you know, you heard it, you're probably guilty of it yourself, that's just the way I am. You ever hear people say that? That's just the way I am. Well, the thing is that we owe it to God to represent Him appropriately. Amen? So the thing is, I wrestle with this question is, why would the Lord expect so much from imperfect people? Have you ever wondered about that? Well, the Bible says in Romans 12 and 18, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all humankind. In other words, as we examine the text, the writer of James, whose name appears as the author of James, was probably the oldest of Jesus' younger brothers. And the thing is that in James gives us instructions which are pretty clear about biblical character. It is the book of James that instructs us about how we should act, what to do, when to speak, where to go, what to avoid, even how to refrain from conflicts with others. Now, the thing is, there are more than spiritual values of doing what God says, okay? But there are also values of making our lives more joyful and peaceful. In other words, I don't know about you, but arguments have a tendency to make my blood pressure go high. Amen. Also, too, conflict causes my glucose level sometimes to kind of escalate too. Amen. Come on, let's keep it real. Am I alone? Okay. Thank you. But the thing is that when you are in conflict, when your stress level escalates, do you not realize that? And I'm not a doctor, and I'm not a nurse, but I just notice the fact that when everything has escalated, your quality of life and your longevity goes down. Us that we can be a builder or we could be a destroyer. And I read from the Message Bible because it states, forget about deciding what's right for each other. Here's what you need to be concerned about, that you don't get in the way of someone else, making life more difficult than it already is. Interesting. I'm convinced, and this is Paul writing, Jesus convinced me that everything as it is in itself is holy. We, of course, by the way we treat it or talk about it, can contaminate it. If you refuse others by making a big issue over what they eat or don't eat, you're no longer a companion with them in love, are you? These, remember, are persons of whom Christ died. Would you risk sending them to hell over an item in their diet? Don't you dare let a piece of God's blessed food become an occasion of soul poisoning. together and completes it with joy. Your task is to single-mindedly serve Christ so that you'll kill two birds with one stone, pleasing the God above you and providing work to the people around you. So let's agree to use all our energy in getting along with each other, helping others with encouraging words. In other words, I don't know, there was a time in my life where I was in the company of some Muslims and they did not eat pork. And I thank God for the pig who sacrificed his life so that I may have bacon and pork chops and some ham on Resurrection Day or whatever time. Or I thank God for the sausage, amen. And also, the thing is, they had a problem with those around them who were eating pork, and they just would just set this all to damn this all to hell and said that, you know, you're going to hell because of what you eat. But it's not so much of what you eat, and that's what Paul was saying. But the thing is that it's your character, okay? But at the same time, too, is that as children of God, we have to be careful that we do not cause someone to stumble because of our actions. Amen? So, the way we live, including the actions we take and the things we do, can either edify our brothers and sisters in Christ, or it can destroy them. In other words, my eating of the pig or the swine could cause my brothers of another faith to stumble because they can't understand, and so therefore they're looking at our actions and how we live and not hearing what we have to say. So the thing is you've got to be careful in the way in which you respond to certain things because, again, it was once stated, I can't hear what you're saying for what I see what you're doing. Amen? So here in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, the 14th verse, it says, follow peace with all men, holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. Also, too, in the Amplified version, it says, try to be at peace with everyone and try to live a holy life because no one will see the Lord without it. Also, too, I want to bring in the scripture of 1 Peter 3, 1 through 2, and it reads as thus, likewise, ye wives, be ye subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives, while they behold your chaste conversation and coupled with fear. And then also too is that in an Amplified version it says, if any of them do not believe God's word, your conduct will win them over to believe it will not be necessary for you to say a word because they will see how pure and reverent your conduct is. Again, we're talking about one's conduct and the way in which one responds that will win someone to Christ. Again, we can talk a good game, and we can preach their house down, and we can, oh, hallelujah, and we can do all kinds of things, but if you do not respond or act what you preach, you are just sounding brass and teeth and cymbal. All you are is just a fill of a noise bag. Amen? The thing is that people are not actually listening to what you're saying. They're watching how you respond. And so the thing is, you've heard me say, you are your neighbor's Bible, and they read you when you meet. Today they read you in your home. I'm talking about your family and friends. All that stuff you talk about, you take home to the house, and you talk about the people at church. My brother's talking about you should be in subjection. But basically what it is, it was Peter, and excuse me, What here Peter's saying that is that women, you should live, those of you who have unsaved husbands, you should live a life that they will see Jesus in you. We sing a song, the God in me, see the God in you, right? And I don't know the words, but again, it's like, because of that, you should see Jesus in me, that you can love me so much, because it's not so much me you see, but it's the God in me you see. Amen. So the thing is here, when we look at 1 Peter, I believe the principle placed here is before transcending genders as it relates to winning others to God, especially friends and family members. Now the thing is despite all that has been said and done, now is the time to put belief into action. And the thing is our problems usually arise when we ignore God's instruction for us personally. In other words, we feel all of the instruction that we receive is for somebody else. But let me let you know something. When you receive the Word of God, it's for you. And the thing is, what you receive, that's what you then are able to share with somebody else. But the change takes place in you first. It's not so much, well, I heard a word for you. Oh, no, sweetheart. You heard a word for you first. And then you can share it with somebody else. Amen. Now, Proverbs 20:3 tells us, Proverbs, it is an honor for a man to cease from strife, but every fool will be mended. Also, too, the Message Bible tells us it's a mark of good character to avert quarrels, but fools love to pick fights. Okay, the Amplified version tells us any fool can start an argument, and the honorable thing to say is to stay out of them. Amen. Any fool can start an argument, but the best thing to do is to stay out of them. Now, notice here in Proverbs 20, it doesn't say you should ignore strife. It says you should cease from it. Some of us have a tendency to want to run away from conflict. Let me let you know something. To run away from conflict doesn't help matters. All it does is allow escalation to take place. The thing is that you have to ask God for wisdom as to how to deal with the situation. But you can't run, because the only thing that's going to happen is it's going to cause more problems to increase. In other words, that when there's a crack in the glass, okay, or when there's conflict, then that allows the enemy to creep in and cause more problems. We have families who are separated today and disconnected because conflict that started very, very small has now escalated to a place where no one can understand, well, where did that come from? Now, I'm not saying that you run away from conflict, but I want to make that clear. However, we have to realize that also true is that we have some folk who will take a match and know that there's problems. Hello. Yeah. And will throw it into a pile of wood and then act like there won't be a fire. Hello. Now you know that if there's already a conflict and there's some fuel already there, you light the match and you're gonna say, you know how they old saying is throw your rock and hide your head? Well, I'm saying you throw your match and then think, oh, ain't nothing gonna happen. Well, baby, it's gonna happen. It's gonna blow up. And then the thing is to wash your hands and say, oh, I didn't know what you were about. Well, then that's what the devil is about. Amen. Amen. Am I right about it today? Yes. Okay, now let's move on. If there is friction in a relationship, you have to deal with it. Ignoring a problem will not make it go away. You have to work to resolve it. Now, I'm going to share with you some ways in which we can handle conflict, and then I'm going to sit down because we know we've got to get ready for this afternoon. Now, the first thing to do is sometimes when you are dealing with conflict, sometimes it helps to just delay. Delay in reacting to what is happening. In other words, you may be angry, and sometimes we have a tendency to just tell people a piece of my mind. But be careful that little piece you may give may be all that you have. in her. Now, often when we are angry, we have a tendency to want to let folk know what's on our mind. And for some, I'm sure you have heard, you know, it's not healthy. You have these counsels. That's why you gotta be also careful who you receive counsel from. Because you will have people who will tell you, you know, sweetheart, it's not healthy to keep all of that in, and you better tell them. And the thing is that when you start fuming and you start fretting, and you gotta let these things off your chest, and don't go to sleep tonight with all that on your chest. Amen. You heard it. You probably told somebody that too. Amen. Well, let me let you know something. We've been told also to hold it on to it. Only makes the problem worse. Now, all of us know that if we ever use this strategy and we have taken this as a part of our life, you know that dealing with conflict, you have probably already learned that what I've just mentioned doesn't really work. Amen. When you want to tell people with a piece of your mind and you want to tell them before you go to bed at night and you want to get up again, it don't always work. Now the thing is that Proverbs 12 and 16 tells us, a fool's wrath is presently known, but a prudent man covereth shame. Also too, in the Message Bible, it says, fools have short fuses and explode all too quickly. The prudent quietly shrug off insults. In other words, a fool shows his annoyance at once, but a prudent man overlooks an insult. Amen, amen. A delayed reaction will give you time to evaluate the situation and help you determine if it's really worth your time. Is it really worth you getting all upset about? Is it really worth getting your blood pressure high, glucose level high, and other kind of thing all kind of high? Is it really worth it? The thing is that delaying and waiting will allow you to say and ask yourself, well, you know what, I'm overreacting. It's not really as bad as I thought it was. And so the thing is, perhaps waiting and delaying will allow you then to realize that if I didn't wait, then I would have to find myself apologizing for foolish behavior later on. Amen? Amen. Now, when you're in conflict, again, I'm talking about ways to handle conflict. When you're in conflict with another person, you don't have to put heat on your words in order to have impact. You ever notice those people who fly out and they give all kind of insults and they give all kind of threats and they're going to do this and I'm going to do that? Well, oh yeah, it may be easy to intimidate someone by yelling, but nothing's ever accomplishing yelling and screaming. It actually, again, you're not dealing with the problem at hand. We need to keep in mind what Proverbs 29:11 says. A fool uttereth all his mind, but a wise man keepeth it till afterwards. Amen. And then also too, the Message Bible tells us, stupid people express their anger openly, but sensible people are patient and hold back. Wow. Amen. So in a sense, whenever you're attempting to resolve conflict with someone, say what you need to say gently and say it firmly. Don't make threats you do not intend to carry out. Because the thing is that when you start making threats and you start kitchen sinking, fighting, and all that kind of stuff, all you're going to find yourself doing is feeling like a fool later on. Amen. Amen. So just say what you mean and mean what you say. And yelling and screaming along with sarcasm is not necessary. Just because you turn up the volume doesn't mean that people are going to hear you anymore. The thing is that you can say what you mean, but turning up the volume, I mean, people are not deaf. They can hear you. So say what you mean what you say and hold off on sarcasm. It's truly not necessary. But also, too, when we look at Proverbs 15:1, a soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up strife. Also, too, is that in the Message Bible, a gentle answer deflects anger, but harsh words make tempers flare. Now, I'm sure all of you can relate to that, because again, if you have two people, one person is right here, and they're already estimated, and they've got a comment to say, and then the other person who then finds and joins them, and they're escalating, and now you have a bunch of two people just escalating, and so who's here? Who? Amen? Okay. Peacemaker or hell-raiser? Okay. Now, handling conflict. Third way is to strike for solutions. Think of the conflict you're currently facing. Now, all of us are facing some kind of form of conflict. If we'll be honest today, we can be delivered. Amen? Now, the thing is, do you find yourself having the same argument again and again, day after day, but yet there's no mention of working toward a solution? This, of course, happens in marriages, it happens in friendships, it happens in parent-child relationships, and work-related conflicts tend to take this stand. If you're having conflict and you're with someone, it's because they're doing something you don't want them to do. That's why we have conflict. When you find that someone is doing what you don't want them to do, then you have an attitude. And when they see that you're doing something they don't want you to do, well, they have an attitude. Well, the thing is that most of our situations when we are in conflict is because we're doing something or someone is doing something that we don't want them to do. So the thing is, in order to resolve the conflicts in your life, you have to be willing to let go of the conflict and direct your attention to a solution. Again, you can have conflict after conflict after conflict, but the thing is, where is the resolution? Amen? Now, Proverbs 15 and 18 tells us, a wrathful man stirs up strife, but he that is slow to anger appeases strife. Also, the Message Bible says, hot tempers start fights. A cool, calm spirit keeps the peace. Amen. So the thing that I say and I want to encourage you today is strive for solutions to conflict. You don't have to keep reminding the other person what they did wrong. Once they have taken steps to make peace, and you have to be willing to accept it and let it go. Also, too, I remember hearing a story about a man who was divorced, and it was in California. And he was to give, he had to pay alimony for his wife. And the thing is that he searched so hard trying to find checks that would allow him to place pictures on the checks. And the thing is, he was a type of person, he was so angry, he would not let things go. So what he did was he went and he found a check, and he had a picture taken of he and his new wife kissing on the check, and so they put that on the check. And he had every intention of sending this check of the alimony to his ex-wife. Now the thing is that when you come to a resolution and people are going on about your business, this is a perfect example of someone who would not let go. Amen. So the thing is, if his wife is going on about her business, again, we have to learn to let things go. Now, as believers, our lives should be one that promotes peacefulness, not a hellion. Amen? And we must realize that there are going to be times when conflict arises, and we need to know how to deal with them in a way that glorifies God. Now, if you have a job, a spouse, children, neighbors, friends, you will have conflict. But today I'm asking is that you have heard the word. Again, you heard the challenge. Are you going to be a peacemaker or a hellraiser? My prayer is that you will adhere to what has been told, and that when you are faced with conflict, that you will remember again, delay, seek a resolution, and again, do not respond immediately, because what will happen is that you'll find yourself again having to apologize for foolish words and foolish behavior. Now, in closing, you can avoid or resolve a conflict in your life by approaching it with wisdom. Delay the reaction. Speak your mind gently but firmly. Ask God for direction in regards to a solution. And try this and you will experience peace in your relationship. The songwriter once said, "What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pains we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer." Children of God, you have to realize that as long as you live and you breathe in this world, you will have conflict. But one thing we know, that when we take a time out and we delay, you can go to God in prayer about it. And tell God about it. And ask God for wisdom. And to ask God to direct you into what, how to deal with the situation. James tells us what to do, how to do, where to do, and how we're supposed to respond. So the thing is, the Word of God has been given to each and every one of us. Take heed to the Word of God. Let us not be hearers of the Word only and not doers. Again, the Word of God has been given. Be wise, not foolish. Be a peacemaker, and not only a peacemaker, but a peacekeeper. Be a peacemaker and not a hellraiser. Again, my question to you this morning is, what is